on Al Lang Field in St. Petersburg, Florida, on a warm, sunny Saturday afternoon. It's a day for baseball history. The first appearance in competition of New York City National League baseball team, the New York Mets.
Line into left field, base hit for Carter, and the Mets are still alive.
Just a small town girl, living in a lonely world. She took the midnight train going anywhere. Just a city boy.
Little roller up along first, behind the bag.
A singer in a smoky room, a smell of wine and cheap perfume. For a smile they can share the night. It goes on and on and on and on. Strangers,
waiting. Lopez wants it away.
And it's a deep to left center. Andrew Jones on the run. This one has a chance. Home run! Mike Piazza! And the Mets lead 3-2.
To the right, into the air to center field. Damon going back to the warning track. It's over his head, and the Mets win it. Damon Wright with a walk-off hit in the bottom of the ninth off Mariano Rivera, and the Mets have taken game one from the Yankees, 7-6.
Don't stop believing.
Hello and welcome to MetsBhoys 17. I'm Jason, I'm in Scotland, and I'm delighted to be joined in Ireland by David Harper. Are you there, Harper?
I'm here, man.
Yep, and in New York City, as usual, we've got Frankie and Nicky. He's there, guys?
Yep.
Yeah, happy days, happy days. Unfortunately, one of the troops, Jock, he's working night shift. Jock's helps keep the industry of looking after people in hospitals alive. Jock's a nurse, so he's doing his bit for the community, and he's working night shift tonight, so he can't join us. But past week, bit of a mixed bag for the Mets. Went not too bad. We had predicted 2-4. We went 3-3. That was including the Sunday night's game against the Braves. So we've won 3, lost 3. Bit of a mixed bag, but not too bad. And hopefully our game just now, we'll get on today. It's a rain delay in the minute at Washington, so hopefully it'll get ahead and we'll finish the series on a high note against the Nationals. And then we start a homestead next week and against two of the weaker teams within the National League. We've got the Rockies and the Astros, so we'll look for a big homestand there for the guys. So, bit of a mixed bag, but we'll nip over to New York City. And what do you think about the past week, guys?
I think it's exactly what you said. I mean, it was an average week. I don't think anything a Mets fan could get upset about, but nothing, right, you know, nothing to get too happy about. Well, I guess you could always...
nothing to get upset.
Well, I guess there's always reason to get upset. But... you know, it was an average week. Two hard teams, you know, the Reds, two first place teams on the road. You know, Cincinnati's a beanbox, so almost fly out of there. Luckily, Cincinnati's missing their best player, but we dropped 2-3 there, which I think, you know, any Mets fan could have seen that coming. You know, I really hope they get this game off today, because if we could somehow get 2-3 on National and go 3-3 on this road trip, I'll be pretty happy. You know, I mean, like you said, I think they have a good homestand coming up. They have a good stretch of games now between the Rockies, the Cubs, and then even they go on the road, but it's the Phillies and Marlins. These are teams now they could be beaten. So we might, you know, my goal right now is I want to see this team finish as close to 500 as possible.
Yeah. What about yourself, Frankie?
I mean, I'm looking right at this point. I mean, I've given up on the season. So all it is looking forward for the future. And this week, we once again saw Matt Harvey just pitch brilliantly. And the team looks good behind him when he pitches. And that's another good sign is that they feel very comfortable with that guy pitching. And the other thing I guess start talking about it now is besides R.A. Dickey, Nice is definitely our second best pitcher we got. And the guy just continues to pitch really well. And even he got a loss earlier in the week. I mean, that wasn't his fault. And he only gave up 4 runs in like 7 innings. So I'm looking forward to the future right now. What I see between Matt Harvey and John Nice is giving me some hope, you know.
Frankie, you know what happened there? I dropped John Nice from my fantasy baseball team. And then he just went off the radar.
Nice is off then.
Jesus.
he really is. There's no doubt R.A. Dickey's been the best pitcher we've had this whole year. He's just been incredible. And, you know, he's still up there with Cy Young running right now. But John Nice is really placed himself now, in my eyes, as the second best pitcher on this team. And you know, we got the September call-ups coming up in a couple of weeks, and you know, maybe we see Zach Wheeler and see what he's got, and see if he's a little closer, and some good things to look forward to. But yeah, I think we should get into discussion a little later about you know, who we think should go on this team in the off season, because I think we got a couple of pieces that we could get something for, you know, and we'll talk about that later. But yeah, I mean, as far as this last week, 2 first place teams, 2 good hitting lineups to be, you know, 3-3. And now, you know, if we get this game in, maybe, you know, 4-whatever, you know.
Yeah, 4-3 for the past 7, past 8 days. No, excellent.
Not bad. So I'm looking forward to the future. So that's a positive for me.
If I could throw one quick point in, if we go back to MetsBhoys 1, one of us said John East was going to have a good year. One of us. I don't want to say any names.
Thanks very much. Thanks.
I've took the credit for Ari, Mickey, but I'll definitely give you the credit for that, Mickey. Yep. I mean, he's still young, he's still learning, but if he puts a couple of things, it's maybe he's got to brush up in his game. He's looks excellent to me, and I'm by no means an expert, but he's really looking good. But Matt Harvey, I just love that kid. That was his second win under his belt, but I mean, the games he lost probably weren't down to him. And no, I thought it was really, really good. And as you say, you notice the way he throws the ball inside, and he goes for the guys, and he's got a presence in that mound, and absolutely delighted with him. But Ari Dickey, sorry Harper, do you want to?
I've not seen much baseball this week, but like, just looking at it, it was a tough road trip. Cincinnati and Washington, 2 top teams. There's a chance of coming out of this 3-3, which is excellent, to be honest with you. Do you know what I mean? Losing the first 2 in Cincinnati, 3-0 and 6-1, you're like, are we going to get the sweep of that bit? Get the next game 8-4, pick up the win last night in Washington. We could maybe get the win tonight if the game goes ahead, which we imagine it probably will at some point. To come out of that road trip 3-3s, it's pretty good, man. I'd be very happy with that. And as you say, like 4 games against the Rockies and then 3 against Houston. I mean, that's, you've got to be looking at, if you want to be a team where, if you're still talking about a team that's maybe an outside chance, you're chasing a wild card spot, right? Which we're probably not, if we're being honest, right? But this next homestead, 7 games, I'd be looking for five with that, like, I swear to God.
I'd be looking for five as well.
I'd be looking for five wins with that if we are a team playing to our capabilities, like.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So, yeah. there's still a tiny wee thing where you think, maybe because you're a fan, every fan still has that hope. But the sensible, the head says, it's probably gone. Like, when you look at the teams above us and the divisions they're competing in, the chances of getting that wildcard spot's a really long shot. But it's still there, and we've still got to push for it. And that's the biggest thing for me. I still want to see the team look like they believe they can still get it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, and until it's mathematically impossible, you need to go for it. But, yeah. I mean, we're definitely out of it. Jock still thinks we'll win the division, do you know what I mean? Jock's optimism is brilliant.
But, you sure he's a nurse and not a patient?
But, no, as far as I'm concerned, it's gone, but team's still got to fight right to the end.
Jason, can I just comment on something Nicky said as well? Just yep. What you're saying about John Nace, like, Nicky, you're 100% on the money. Like, when you think what you were hoping for John Nace this season, what you were expecting, he's probably exactly right now where we hoped he would be. Do you know what I mean? There can be no complaints, like, and that is really a big positive going forward, like, for such a young guy, like.
The only thing I could say I'd like to see from John Nace, but I guess there's a lot of pitches, just more consistency.
Mm-hmm.
You know, more consistency, especially with his curveball. You know, he's not, there's some games he just can't get it over for a strike.
And
last night he was pitching great last night. But, you know, I'd like to see a little more consistency. I think he's still working, I think, on a two-seamer or something like that. I think he's still working on some pitches. So he's still just developing, but he definitely has come a long way. And I thought, you know, just watching the spring training, I had a feeling he'd have a breakout year. But he's still learning. You know, I don't expect him to be a Hall of Fame caliber pitcher. But, you know, when you have Harvey and Wheeler probably going to top your rotation next year, having Nice three, because in my eyes, to me right now, you know, well, I know you got Dickey, but those are your top three for the future, Harvey, Wheeler, and Nice, you know, so.
Yeah, and if we get Pelfrey back, I mean, I know he was a bit of a, I actually think he pitched the start of the season pretty well, so if we get him back fit, he can still, add something. I've got big worries about Santana. I don't know, Frankie called it a few weeks ago just to rest him for the end of the season. I watched the game on Friday night, and he started off okay, but when he lost it. You know, he loads the bases and just throws one right down the middle, and the guy cracks out of the park for a grand slam. It's just, it's not nice to watch. And I seen Terry come out, or was it Dan Warding? He came out and spoke to him, but he left him in. But obviously, Santana's always going to, he's confident in his own ability and stuff like that. So he'll always, I think he was the type that'll always say, no, I'm fine. But he got the hook not long after that, and I've got genuine concerns about if we'll ever see a great Santana again. And after that, no hitter, it's such a disappointment, because he is a top class pitcher when he's on his day.
Jason, do you not feel that watching Santana is a wee bit like watching a guy who was a top class player, and it's a wee bit different, but you know when like a player leaves Celtic, right, and they were brilliant, and then they come back again, and they're just not the same. And it's actually quite sad. Like, you're watching a guy who's just not, he's not going to capture that sort of status anymore, in my opinion. I think it's gone from him. I really think it's gone from him.
I don't know that, because Nicky pointed out one of the earlier episodes as well, how he's a very, very clever pitcher.
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully, if he gets rest and he comes back next season fully rested and his arm's back, then I think he is the kind of guy, he is a clever pitcher, he knows his limitations, you would think. But I don't know what you guys think. What do you think, Nicky and Frankie?
I think he'll, exactly what you said, he's a clever pitcher. He just needs some rest. He needs to rest that arm, rest the ankle too, and just come back, shut it down, get ready for next season. If he's ready, maybe play a little bit of winter ball, you know, and just get ready for the season next year. He's not doing any good trotting him out there. It's not like...
Hello?
Oh, no, we've lost Frankie and Nicky, I think. I can still hear you, Jason.
Yep. Skype's still on, but let me see.
They're back. Yeah.
Right. So carry on.
The wonders of live radio.
We lost you. We lost you a bit just when you were saying about get a bit of winter ball. We didn't hear anything after that.
Just get you know, maybe play a little bit of winter ball, shut them down, and just get them ready for next year. And I think me and Nick were talking about this. He's going to be a great guy to teach these younger guys. Mm. He's a pro's pro. And keep them around and just, you know, get ready for next year and we'll take it from there. But he's doing no good trotting them out there and giving up gopher balls after the third inning.
Nicky, that's a valid point. Like, Frankie, sorry, that's quite a valid point because sometimes you forget what these guys add away from actually playing live, if you know what I mean, what they add to, like, the dressing room or the locker room, if you like, to these younger guys. Because obviously Santana as a mentor and a guy that all the pitchers will look up to.
Oh, I still think Johan Santana is going to play a huge role on this team. It's just It's not going to be off the hill. And that's another point I made, I think, last week, is I also want to see them go. I know they're not looking to spend a lot of money, but there might be a veteran catcher out there. I know they just got Kelly Schapper, but there might be a really good – you need a good catcher, too. You want Johan's job from now on, he's not the ace anymore. You know, right now it's Dickie and Nice. Those are the aces. Johan's job right now is to get healthy. That's a goal for Barcelona. It is to get healthy. But just to mold the two young kids, I don't think we're going to see Wheeler in September. I don't think he's ready. They're saying he's not ready. But there's another kid we're going to see in September. We've seen him in the past. It's Mejia.
Mejia's
going to come up as a starter, too. Like, we have so many young pitchers, and then that kid Familia, and I found this kid Hefner hasn't been too bad either.
No, he's pitched well.
He's pitched pretty well, you know. So he's got a role to play with all these young pitchers. Yet, to me, I would throw Johan out as your fourth starter next year. Like, you know, and that's that.
Nicky, see when you talk about Hefner being, and he has been decent. Like, does it then become when, like, are we talking like Pelfrey be back next year as well, right? And you look at your five starters, does somebody like Hefner move into the bullpen then and become a really good reliever? Like,
no, I'd rather see Pelfrey go to the bullpen.
Yeah, Pelfrey's a reliever. Heard that a lot, eh? I've heard a lot of people say that.
He's a big guy. He looks like a reliever, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So there is optimism in the pitching. There is, like, for next year, like, do you know what I mean? I know we've been really down on the pitching at times, but there is a lot of optimism there as well, like.
Yeah,
well,
down in the
bullpen.
I mean, the thing is, see if we've got every pitcher fit, and obviously that's something that probably doesn't happen very often in most baseball clubs. But if we've got every pitcher fit, we've got definitely the fruits of a quality rotation and even a half decent bullpen as well. If we've got every pitcher fit, but no, it's, I don't know. But what about the one that we lost? We got Kelly Schopak in as a catcher, and we lost Pedro Beato with an ERA of 4,000. So what do you think he'll add to the Boston Red Sox?
Sorry,
man. I'm just mad because the guy was from Woodside, so I'm kind of bummed that we lost the only Woodside contingent on the Mets. But nah, a no trade for a no trade. What's Kelly going to do for us? Hey, if he does anything for us, it's a bonus. So I'm just looking at it, you know. What is he? Is his contract, it's up this year, right? Sopic?
Yeah, he's done, I think, after the year. So he'll be a free agent.
So it's a free agent. So it's like a wash. So who knows? Maybe, you know, he impresses a little bit and maybe we re-sign him. But, yeah, it's a no big deal, that kind of deal.
He's a probably step up for Nikias, but I wouldn't even go as far to say he's better than Tolley.
Nah,
I would still have Tolley as our number one catcher in the team. Yeah.
I think Schopek has a little better of a bat, you know, than Tolley, but I think they're comparable. I think they're going to mix it up. I think Schopek's better against lefties or something like that. Yeah, they're going to mix it up the rest of the way. You know, maybe Schopper could actually, he's been around a while, he's been seen a couple, maybe Schopper could actually teach Tolley a few things, but as much as I love Josh Tolley, I just don't see him as the catcher of the future. I really don't.
Good backup.
Yeah, great backup. You know, slow as anything. I mean, I understand you're a catcher, but Jesus Christ, hit some wind sprints. I mean, he really defined slow. But
John Olerud slow.
Yeah, John Olerud probably beat him in a race, though.
I don't know about that.
But no, but I do like Toye. You know, he definitely got a decent stick. Yeah, I think Shopik's comparable. It's nice to have two good options at catcher.
Yep.
You know, but you know, I don't think Shopik is gonna be around next year. They're saying it's a tryout, but I don't know.
So Nicky, what if Shopik puts up good numbers and for the rest of the year? Does it put us in a position where, because I don't think, to be honest, I don't think we're looking at him or Tolley being an everyday catcher if we can get somebody better. So what would be the situation then? I mean, it'd really be a toss-up between the two of them, would it?
Yeah, well, no, it depends how much money this guy's going to command. I mean, if he puts up good numbers and shows that he can add value to the team,
mm-hmm.
he's going to be a cheaper option. He's not going to demand $10 million a year. I mean, he might ask for $1 million for a couple of years.
And but would you be happy with those two then next season? That's what I'm kind of... If he puts up decent numbers and he gets a contract, would you be happy with him and Tolley next season?
No. Me personally,
that's
no.
The thing,
I think they could do the job, and I definitely would be good. I have no quarrels with both of them being the catcher of the organization, but as I stated, my concern is those guys, what we want our young pitchers thrown to day in, day out. Maybe they are. You know, Shopik's been around a while. He's got some experience, so maybe he can play a role in helping the young pitchers develop. I won't say I'd be happy with the two of them, but I wouldn't be miserable. You know, I definitely see other areas we could add some pop in our lineup than catcher. So
it's just that we discussed recently, the used guys especially said that the catcher was the most important position in the team. That's the reason I asked that, because then if that is the most important position, would we be happy with those two going forward next year? Like,
yeah.
So possibly we're looking for an upgrade in that department. So I think, to me, Tolley's a good stopgap. And I would love to see him as the number two catcher.
Yeah.
But I'd love to see someone, a dominant guy there with a good bit of experience. But obviously these guys are not coming cheap. So, while we're on the subject of catchers, Harry Dickey at the Great American Ballpark, Bracelet Gate, what was that all about? Has he been wearing the bands all year that his daughter made him?
All year.
So what's this umpire's beef then?
You know, it's just one of those quirky kind of things. Like, Terry Collins actually talked about it the next day. The same day that they had R.A., cut off the two bracelets given to him by his little girls.
Before they went on the hike, wasn't it?
Yeah, 8 months ago or something like that. He's had them on for that same day. King Felix threw a no hitter, and somebody sent Terry Collins like a photo of it, and basically King Felix had a big gold bracelet on mm-hmm. on it. On his glove hand, you know, the same hand that R.A. had his bracelets on it. And it's just one of those things. He's had it on for 8 months. Ooh. He's pitched, I don't know, 30 times.
Frankie, do you think it actually came for the umpire, or could it be a case, say, a bit of gamesmanship and the opposition maybe complained about it and maybe to try and get an Ari's head?
Supposedly...
Because that's what I was thinking at the time. When I heard that at the time, I thought, I bet that's the opposition have complained.
I thought the same thing, but supposedly the umpires have come out and basically said that it had nothing to do with the Reds, that it was
okay.
It was just the umpire that saw that and asked them to remove it.
Mm.
I mean, I've seen guys with big gold chains that hang out of their jerseys or rosary beads, and they've either been told to put it back in your jersey. If it keeps popping out, then you have to take it off. And then, you know, you see other umpires that'll just let that kind of stuff go. It's quirky like that. It's happened before. I mean, I've known they've asked pitchers to cut the strings on their gloves because it was distracting hitting. You know, like that's usually gamesmanship. But supposedly that was nothing from the Reds. That was just the crew umpire. And it wasn't even Jim Joyce who was the head of the umpire crew.
It's just a weird thing. Like,
yeah, I agree.
Because you think your big argument would be, well, I've had it on for so many games, how is it different tonight? Like, and you would lose the plot. Like,
but I suppose it is in the rules, but you can understand, like, for I suppose any other, well, maybe giving guys up at the plate as well, but especially a pitcher, see, if your head goes, you can forget it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's all about like winning the battle in your head.
Mm-hmm.
But I suppose it's like any sport. If you're at the top of any sport, you've got the core ability because you've made it to the top. But it's how right your head is. I mean, you all know a football player, if he's a striker or whatever, if he's in a hot streak, you know, he'll score every ball that comes in the box. But if he's actually struggling, the goal will seem about 2 feet wide. But it obviously didn't do him any favours, but yeah, I don't think he used it as any excuse. But
Jason, that's kind of sort of, when you're saying that about the head going, and that's exactly as Frankie says, that's what made me think it was maybe the opposition to think, well, this will be a way to get into Harry Dickey's head. He's the biggest threat on the Mets pitching staff, so maybe this is the way we can get him. But if the umpires are saying that wasn't the case, then that wasn't the case then, I suppose.
I know, but you're right, and the guys, the background guys for the Reds would maybe be studying videos of Harry and say, wait a minute, he's got a bracelet on there, that's against the rules. So yeah. if we're struggling against him, just get a wee word to the umpire. So, no, you never know. And as I say, especially when you're at the top and you're vying for your divisional title, you'd maybe do anything to try and win it, but apparently it's not the case. I'm glad, because I wouldn't like to think that was the case. But definitely looking forward to Matt Harvey, seeing some more of him. As you say, potentially maybe not see Zach Wheeler, I don't know, but I think hopefully, and there's murmurs coming out for Terry Collins, he isn't adverse to putting Santana out for the rest of them for the rest of the season, and I definitely think that's the way to go. So what about our outfield? Where do we think of an interesting thing? I know, you know, San Francisco Giants, they're in the middle of Drumgate. I mean, I think everybody's pot them all sorts over in San Francisco, and do you think that's maybe the reason Torres has been a bit brutal for us, because he's had to come off the gear when he signed for us?
Oh, but wait a minute, no, Jason.
No, he's been good lately.
I know I was a bit of a Torres cheerleader at the start of the year, so maybe I've been a wee bit biased. I'm trying to say I wasn't wrong, but I think since the break, after that bad homestead we had, I think Torres has been no bad. Like,
his bat's been pretty good. Like, just make a joke about San Francisco.
Nah, I know, man, but I just feel I've got to defend my man. Like,
yeah, no, he's been okay. What about David Wright since the All-Star break? He looks as if he's needing a rest.
Jason, didn't he talk about that after the trade we tried to pull, man? You know what I mean? You're dangerous ground there. Like,
David's definitely—he's looked like the hitter in the past few years. He just—you know—they're pitching him inside, and that seems to—you know—that seems to be affecting him now. I don't know if it's just he's tired. I don't know if it's just everybody's on a funk. You know, oh my goodness. I mean, it's, I'm sorry. We have the Barca game on. There's been 4 goals in 15 minutes, which is kind of shocked. But
yeah, I think it's 4-0.
3-1. But he's definitely, Wright's obviously not the player he was in the first half right now. You know, but I think, you know, I don't want to say he's, We got to see how he finishes the year, because the Mets, the rest of the year, they got a lot of home games. So all it takes is a couple of good wins at home to get a little roll going, get back into the swing of things. You know, Wright could, you know, save a season. You know, people, you're going to go through funks throughout the season. It's a long season.
And he's going for what is the 300 home run.
Yeah, 300, yeah. He's got a lot of, yeah, maybe that's putting pressure on him. But
I think that is. I think he's been up to things like, kind of Gary Carter was going for 300 for like 3 months. You know, I think it's one of those things. Once he gets that home run, I think it's going to break. I think
Wright's going to finish the year. I mean, even with this funk, he's still batting what, 320. I think, you know, Wright. I think he's going to have a good streak before. He's not going to finish the year like this. I think he's just going through a funk right now. He's a professional. He'll get back into it. And I really do think this will be the week he does it. I mean, we're playing two bad teams with really bad pitching. I mean, the Cubs, their only good pitcher they traded, you know, so I want to see them again, they're not making the postseason, but I want to see them come out this week and start playing good. You have a lot of home games the rest of the year. Wright especially, you've been in a funk. These are the teams you need to break out of the funk against. Beat these teams. You got the not the Cubs. I think it's the is it the Astros and the Rockies or the
yeah, the Rockies and Astros. Astros.
Rockies and Astros. Two bad teams. David's in a funk. This is the week he should break out of it. If he doesn't break out of it, you know, maybe start raising a bit of a concern. But I just think he's going through a rough patch.
I fully expect Wright to break out as well, just for the fact as well that he wants to be in a strong position to bargain in the summer as well with the front office, like when he's looking for discussing his new contract. Do you know what I mean? But so I mean,
if they discuss it, I mean they're going to pick up his option next year because his option. Everybody's like, oh, they're not going to pick up his option. People need to pay attention. His option is only adding one more million per year. The Mets are not going to, even if they don't negotiate a new long term deal. The Mets are going to pick up his option. It only adds $1 million in payroll.
Yeah.
And to go back to a guy you brought up before that we were talking about, we might not see Mike Pelfrey in a Met uniform next year.
I think
he's up for arbitration this year. And let's face it, the Mets are – he's not going to win it. He's going to get non-tendered and become a free agent, probably.
Yeah. Nicky, just explain what that means then, arbitration.
I was gonna say that.
Just for people who – just because obviously me and Jason know, just anybody that's listening.
Like a certain amount of time, you're up for arbitration. It's all legal job. But basically, you go, a mediator comes in, and...
Sorry, Nicky, see before you actually get there. What is it, have you came to the end of your contract, or is it only if you're a certain age? Is arbitration only for young kids? Or what does it entail? What does it mean?
All right, we need the pure dummy guide.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's basically what it is. It's you get to a certain... stage in your contract or how many years you've been in the league, and you can go in front of an arbitrator. He takes the stats, what you've done the last couple of years, what you've done that year before, and he comes and he tells basically what the going rate is in Major League Baseball for a player of your caliber. Then the Mets have to sit there and basically say, okay, he did all those good things, but he also made this many errors. Teams don't like to get into that whole thing because you basically have to sit across from this guy and badmouth him in front of a third-party guy. So no team wants to go to arbitration.
But Frankie, yeah. I still don't understand. I still don't understand how he gets that. What is the reason he's in arbitration when another player isn't? What is it that what is the scenario that takes that?
Mate, you go to the arbitration.
Aye.
I think it's how many years your contract, basically up for a contract.
Just give us an example. When we're saying Pelfrey, what is it? He's got a year to go, or he's out of contract, or?
Well, there's certain years of service, and I don't want to get it wrong. It's a player with 3 or more years of service, but less than 6 years. He could file for arbitration.
Right.
Oh, so he files for it?
Yeah.
Oh, right. So effectively, it's down to the player to file for arbitration, and then it goes to arbitration.
And he has to have that 3 years service first.
Well, no. What I think is because a player could be classified as what's called a Super 2 and be eligible for arbitration with less than 3 years of service, which I think he has at least 2 years of service, but less than three. I don't know the exact real things, but Mike Pelfrey, there's a chance because of arbitration and the Mets doing something called non-tendering, which pretty much means letting him go. He might become a free agent. And honestly, I think that's like $5, $6 million off the payroll. So
it's very complicated, man. It's hard to follow that kind of stuff.
I've looked up arbitration on Wikipedia, and it says arbitration, a form of alternative dispute resolution, and is a legal technique for the resolution of disputes outside the courts, where the parties to a dispute refer it to one or more persons, i.e. the arbitrators, by whose decision they agree to be bound. So effectively, if the Mets have got a problem, or if Pelfrey's got a thing, they can refer it to arbitrators, and they'll come up, as the guy says, with a suitable package or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's essentially what it is. So someone's got to actually initiate it before it actually gets there. Because if Pelfrey's pretty happy with his contract and he's willing just to run it down, and the Mets are pretty happy with his contribution and they're willing to renegotiate or let him go as a free agent, it wouldn't go to arbitration. Is that correct?
Yeah, I'm not 100% sure on how the rule is. Yeah, I've been following this my whole life, and I never really understood it.
I know because it's mad stuff for us. See from not being brought up in a baseball background, and the terminology here, it just sends me potty. I have no idea what's going on.
Especially when you're sitting here pissed.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's just confusing because it's like you're a free agent or you're not. You know, I don't understand why arbitration comes into play. Well, why do you need to go to court either with the team or you're not? And this is what's kind of frustrating. You know what? If there's a player in a contract and he wants out, sell him.
Yeah, and that's sort of where I'm coming from. But see, obviously our big sport here that we've spoken about it numerous times, you guys have it as well, as football and soccer. But and since the John Mark Bosman court ruling, he was a little-known Belgian player, the players in the European soccer are, even all throughout the world, the players have all the power. You know, players just leave clubs, do the dirty in clubs, just go for where there's more money. But it's different in baseball, because baseball, the clubs still own the players. And this is sort of getting my mindset right. I always wonder, why can't a Bosman-type thing go to the courts in America? And to me, it's one of the worst things that's happened in football, because it's sent the game's actually potty and the players have got so much power now. Mm-hmm. It's terrible. It had to go from one extreme to the next. You know, there was no middle ground, whereas there's no, the clubs get shafted left, right and centre now by players. And the amount of money the players are taking out of the game, it's just unbelievable. You know, at the end of the day, people are getting paid for being top sportsmen, but the money football players earn nowadays, it's absolutely obscene. So, for the fans especially, and I know you've got a big culture there, as we've spoke about with guys like Jason Bay and stuff like that, we know how much money's on, hence why they get booed and stuff. But it's football. You see the crowds are dropping. The crowds are dropping all over Europe, apart from Germany, where they've got sort of, they've got like wage caps or whatever. Their games run a lot better than most. But the crowds are dropping. In the English Premiership, you'll very rarely get sellouts now. There's spare seats in most stadiums now, just because people, first of all, there's an economic downturn. Obviously, a lot of people are losing their jobs and their skin. But a lot of people are turned off by the money the players are earning. It's absolutely obscene.
See, the arbitration as well, it seems to come across as a bit of a, if a player isn't happy with where he is, it seems to be maybe a wee bit of a chance of a get-out clause for him.
Yeah, and I think it's actually, you know, Mike Pelfrey's been on the Mets 6 years, I think, after this. And I think, because there's a lot of different rules with arbitration, ways to go, there's that Super 2, but anybody with 6 years, I think, gets eligible for arbitration. So, I don't know. Yeah, so, and let's face it, I mean, I was reading that report Adam Rubin put the other day, and Adam Rubin probably understands. I'd love to get someone who really understands this to explain it to me as well. But Adam Rubin says he fully expects his, you know, Mike Pelfrey to come off the payroll next year.
Jason, there's maybe a wee question for your secret podcast tomorrow. Arbitration, explain it, please, Mister blah blah blah.
It could be. Yeah, I've sent an alternative. Hopefully, we can get Nicky involved next week. But if not, I'll be doing a wee special show tomorrow night, and it'll be aired on MetsBhoys. Should be pretty good. But for the rest of the season, the last week or two, I was gutted because of the realisation that we're not going to make the postseason and we're not going to win the World Series and stuff like that. And it's just when you get the acceptance. I think I'm at the stage now that I've accepted it and I just want to watch the guys for the rest of the season. And I mean, I was still pumped for the game on Friday night, you know, and I was disappointed at the end, obviously, when Santana gave up the Grand Slam. But no, I'm still really up for watching them. And hopefully, as you say, we can put a run together, get back to 500, and hopefully the crowds will sort of come back, because we've got a good young team and with the potential. But as you say, well, you brought it up earlier, Frankie, but so what about now? Let's go through the team and who we think we could move on, and who we... Another thing as well, John Roush, he's been actually pitching not too bad. What do you think, guys, from the bullpen?
John Roush, look, he had a bad start, but I think ever since June, he hasn't been bad. I mean, I like him. I want him to stay on the team.
Once he got his elbow cleaned out.
Yeah, he had that injury. Once he got that injury done, he came back and he's been pretty effective. His numbers still look high because he was so atrocious in the beginning. Yeah. But, I mean, the other night, I think it was the Harvey game. I mean, he came in when Frankie was making a disaster of it. Mm. He comes in, throws three fastballs, game's over. You know, and he's a big dude. He's not afraid to go at hitters. You know, he's not easily intimidated. Totally like John Roush. So if we're going to talk about him, I hope they keep him in the bullpen.
Because he's a free agent at the end of this season, I think, isn't he? I think he was only signed on a one-year deal. Is that correct?
I think so.
I think we need to negotiate and maybe try and keep him. But Manny Acosta, I would chase him. I know. Terry says he done well with the second half of last season. He actually looks as if he's got some decent stuff. But, oh, man, he gives me heart failure.
Yeah, he's got to go.
We're agreed in that. Snoop Dogg must go. But Big Frank Francisco, I've backed him. You know, he's done no bad, but he's heart attack material as well. I suppose we need. What about as well? I know we've slated Jason Bay, but I think we should actually get rid of Jason Bray and bring David Bay in. Because we're calling David
another,
right?
Popped
one out of the park.
See, for me, man, right? See, like, going forward next year, I'm quite happy to keep the nucleus of this team together. Like, even the offense, it's not been that bad, man. If you could just add a big bat, you know what I mean? Add a big bat and improve the bullpen, I'd be quite happy, like, to keep sort of developing the way we are, these younger players with another year under their belt sort of thing. Like, I'm not overly concerned about that. If we could just add one power bat in the middle of the order and improve the bullpen, like.
Yeah, my outfield's not great. I'm actually really liking Ike Davis. I think Ike Davis is, he's really impressed me the way he came out of his funk, because he was atrocious at the start of the season. But I think he's still streaky, though, man.
He's still really streaky, like.
Yeah, but I think to come out of that depression and play the way he's been playing, He has a power bat for us, but it seems to be it's always single home runs we hit. It's just the positions where we get our home runs, there's very rarely empty in base. I don't know if whatever the reason is, the lineup or whatever. But so, Frankie, back to yourself, mate. You mentioned at the start who we could hang on to, who we'd get rid of. So let's hear it. What's your master plan for the Mets,
Frankie? If I could just maybe put the same question to you in a slightly different angle. When you said earlier, it might have been Nicky when you said there was a couple of players that had value that we could move on. I'd kind of like to get your feelings on that as well, which it's kind of the same thing. It's the same question but a different kind of angle.
Yeah, no. And I got two different answers. Now the one answer is if we're going to go out and actually spend money. Mm-hmm. Now if we're going to go out and we're going to spend money, which means we're going to go out and spend between $10 to $15 million on a power bat to put in the outfield, and then spend say another $10 million on two good pitchers in the bullpen. If we're going to go and spend $20-25 million extra, which brings us up to what, $115 million payroll?
No, it's not going to happen. So I'm not going to.
So if that's the case, then the only guy that I would get rid of is. I would move Danny Murphy and to whoever gives us the best deal for him in the off season. But if we're not going to go out and spend money, then what I would do is Murphy gets traded.
Hairston.
Ike Davis gets traded.
Scott Hairston, he must have a bit of value.
Yeah, I don't. What do we have? What's our contract situation?
I think we still have him one more year.
So if we have him one more year, he would be another guy I would definitely trade.
What is his position like? Because he seems to be he'd be perfect for the American leagues as a designated hitter.
Oh, big time! And then he could just do what he does here and be a utility guy.
Mm.
He could play any place in the outfield. He could play probably two or three positions in the infield.
Scott Hairston's gone after this year.
He's not. So we don't. We don't get anything for him, but if that's the case, then I move Ike Davis. I sell Ike for the highest price. stick Duda at first base. You get your power bat there. You know, he's, because that guy's never going to be able to the outfield. He's just too slow. No way. Duda can't play the outfield. Yeah, you know, guys like, and then as far as like just seeing you can get some cheap right-handed bat to stick in the outfield for, you know, $4 million or so. And definitely trade Murphy. We could stick Valdi at second base. Let him and Tejada get a partnership together. Then eventually, I guess you would just have to definitely sign David Wright. That'll be a big money signing. And you could probably get something decent for Murph and for Ike Davis. And then you just basically have to tell the fans, you're going to have to wait until Zach Wheeler and Matt Harvey are your two stars going on, and just hope that Nice continues at the rate that he is, and that you pick up another guy along the way from the farm team.
I tell you something, right? See, if we don't re-sign David Wright, I will be absolutely heartbroken.
It can't happen. I mean, the Mets aren't that stupid. They're pretty dumb. The people that run this franchise, but they're not that dumb. They really aren't. They're not that dumb. David Wright is way more of a matinee idol than Jose Reyes ever was.
He's the bums on seats guy for the Mets.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, like I said, Marty, who went to his first Met game with us this year, he just turned to me and he said, you know, after like 5 minutes of being in Citi Field, and said, I don't know who this guy Wright is, but he must be good because everybody has his name on their shirt.
Yep.
And it would be devastating to the fan base.
It's unthinkable. Honestly, it would be second only to Seaver leaving. Mm-hmm. It really would. And I don't think this franchise could handle that at this moment, to tell you the truth. If they never re-signed David Wright, there would be a mass exodus of Met fans. I'm dead serious.
I would believe that to be the case. That's what I would expect that as well.
So yeah, my wife's even got a T-shirt with Bright in the back, number 5.
Yeah,
because I can remember Frankie. I can remember the story you told me. It was years ago. It was one of the first times I'd met yourself, and it was old Shea Stadium. We went to Mets Dodgers game. And you were giving me, obviously, getting through the team, and you say there was women turning up at City Field in wedding dresses,
yeah,
and stuff like that, asking David Wright to marry them.
Jason, slightly off topic, right? When you talk about T-shirts, right? This is going back to Philadelphia, the shithole, right? I was in Philadelphia. This is how much they hate us in Philadelphia, right? And I went every single sports shop in the city centre. And the only Mets T-shirts they had was Jason Bay on the back. That's how much they hate us. That's how much they take the piss.
Oh,
man. And I bought one.
You bought one?
Yeah, I've got one.
On you go, Nicky.
No, you were saying.
No, carry on, mate. I was just going to talk rubbish.
No, I was going to say, you know, I kind of agree. I think it's time to part ways with Danny Murphy. I think he does have value. I think Don Mattingly's in love with the kid from everything I heard, and the Dodgers got some people over there. Maybe we get another arm. For now, you know, I really want to see Valdespin in the lineup every day, and I really want him to see him comfortable, and I think he needs to be playing his natural position. He had a gap in the outfield last night, you know, and you know, you can only get mad at him so much. I mean, the Mets for a long time have done this with players, just played them out of position, and, you know, it kind of... You could ruin with them mentally. So I want to see Valdespin. Yeah, Murph. Look at Murphy. I mean, he's never. I don't think he's ever going to be the power hitter they kept saying he was going to be. But, you know, he's comfortable now at second. He's hitting the ball well. But I don't know. I think it's time to part ways with him. I think we could put Valdespin at second and find a better power bat. I mean, you know, Davis is a power bat. Duda has the potential to be a power bat. But we do need a corner outfielder that could sock 30 home runs. And, you know, we're not going to do that when you keep having to put Valdespin in the outfield just to get the kid at bats.
Nick, you see as well, like, Murphy at second base, he's a bit of a square peg in a round hole there, to be honest, isn't he?
Yeah, but I mean, he's gotten better.
I mean, he has got better, but he has...
definitely has come a long way. I don't, you know, I can't, he definitely put the effort in to learn the position. But you want someone who it's natural for, you know.
Put it this way, Nick, you're right. A different way to look at it, if he moves on, he'll not move on to another club and play second base. I don't think.
The natural position, which is third base.
Mm-hmm.
First. Yeah, he's not bad at first.
He's not bad at first, but, I mean, the kid's a third baseman.
Yeah.
They wanted his bat. The Mets felt that this kid was going to hit 30 home runs a year, so they started sticking him in the outfield and toying with his head. And you know, like you said, he's going to move on, play third base, and probably do pretty well for a team.
Mm-hmm.
And see, to be honest with you, see if the team that signs him has got a few power bats in the lineup, so they're not dependent on him to be a power bat. He is a steady Eddie type player. That it's a very low risk gamble for them because they know what they're going to get. Mm-hmm. You know, he's got good numbers. He gets on base a hell of a lot of the time, and he's definitely something that would add something to a team that had a few power bats and they were just looking for the, because if he's Mr. Dependable to get on base.
And Jason, do you know what as well? Like when Nick is saying he's going to go somewhere else as a third baseman, he's suddenly a kind of, he's kind of a utility player now because he's played at second base and he's a decent first baseman, but he's had a year at second base as well, so any team kind of gets that as a wee advantage. They take him as a third baseman, but they know they can move him to second base because he's had a year there with the Mets as well. Like.
Yep. No, I'd be sad to see him go, but I think our
me too.
We've got enough steady Eddies in the team sort of thing. We're sitting there with the lack of a power bat. But you turned the baseball on there, Harper?
What?
Have you turned the baseball on there?
No, I was just taking my jeans off.
I can hear the coverage.
No, it's not for me. No, it's for the guys, it's not for me.
And you guys get the ball game on?
We got the Barcelona match on. I just knew it.
Do you know what? It's coming. It's coming from me.
Okay, you got one guy who doesn't know his computer's on, the other guy's stripping. What's going on here?
I'm waiting for a pass, right?
It's for me. Sorry. Hey, give me a sec. Hey, that's it. It's turned the sound off. It was just because of MLB. MLB.com on, and it just went to the exclusive look in at the Rangers and Blue Jays coming at the ninth inning. So sorry about that, guys. Right,
you know, it'd be a good fit for him. You know, a team that he might excel on is Houston. You know, so I know they're a bad team as it is, but like they're going to the American League. It's a nice hitter's park, big gaps for when he hits the doubles. You know, I mean, they might have some players they're looking to get. They really have nothing. Yeah, but he does add value to some team out there that the Mets should offload him. I think it's, like you said, we'll be set to see him go. He's a good Met, but I think it's time to move on from the Danny Murphy experiment.
Yeah, I know, but I like him. And as I say, he's pretty dependable, but we need to sort of try something new. As you say, the team that we have at the minute, it definitely needs freshened up and it needs some new blood. But if we're not going to spend big money, yeah, we need to look at the guys that we've got value for. And Danny Murphy would definitely be one of them. I must admit as well, see if we could get Johan Santana fit and we could get him pitching a good few games and he looks as if he's back, I would definitely trade him.
Next year at the trading deadline, Johan Santana. And dare I say, if we can't come to an agreement, R.A. Dickey. Those could be two pieces to move next July. Because I don't know what the Mets' plans for Dickey is. And we all love R.A. Dickey, but if this guy wants a 5-year contract, you know,
I would give him
do you give it to him? You know,
I'm keeping him as well.
I think, because he's a knuckleballer as well. One point I meant to mention about John Neese, the thing about Nicky is, Dickey, he always goes deep into the game. I mean, the amount of complete games he throws and he gets into the eighth inning, that's one thing where Neese has got to, build on, because he normally gets hooked about the sixth inning. So when Neese is up, a lot of the time you're putting a lot of pressure on your bullpen. And maybe it wouldn't be highlighted as much if our bullpen wasn't so rubbish. But if we had a decent bullpen, it maybe wouldn't come in. But Neese, I think, has got to have to start sort of going longer into games. And then I would be a lot more into him. Do you agree with that, guys?
Hey, I think you might have just kind of convinced me that maybe it is worth giving him a long... Like, I was under the impression, like, he is older. Yes, he's great. He's a knuckleballer. You know, but do we need him for 5 years with all the young pitching we have? But you're right. Even when he's older, he could play the role of a like a LeVon Hernandez, you know, a guy who, he's not a great pitcher, but he goes out and gets you 200 innings either.
I'd rather give him like 4 and a 5th option kind of, you know, that kind of deal.
Well, we'll see. But here's the thing. I mean,
well, what about trading Ike Davis then?
I would be okay trading. The only thing that it scares me with trading Ike Davis is Ike Davis does a lot defensively.
He's great at first base. I think he's absolutely fantastic defensively. And he's that big. See, a first baseman, but I think anyway, I think it's a real bonus that you're very tall. Mm-hmm. Because see the reach that he's got. If David Wright's maybe, he's threw it away for the plate, Big Ike just sort of reaches out there and just sort of pulls the ball in.
Do you think Lucas Duda could potentially do that? I mean, obviously, could potentially do that job, but I can agree. I think you could get value for Davis, and you've got Lucas Duda to come in there ready-made replacement.
I like Ike Davis.
Well, I like Ike Davis too. He definitely is a bigger target at first, but again, I've said Ike Davis is a beautiful swing. He's got pop. I really do expect Duda to start tearing the ball up. He's a bigger framed guy. He's got the power. You know, he could hit a lot. I think he'll hit more home runs over the course of his career than Ike Davis, but that's just my opinion. I could be 100% wrong. The only thing is, again, though, Ike Davis, especially with David Wright, he's not the best thrower. You know, I mean, Ike Davis has helped David Wright, I can't count how many times.
Yeah, definitely. But Harper, you enjoying the crisps?
No, it was Jacob's Elite Chocolate Tea Cake. Just to put in the picture, did you ever see the Tom Cruise film Risky Business? That's me the now with the tighty whities, white socks, but with ginger hair. Like ginger Tom Cruise in Risky Business. I'm sitting here, it's absolutely sweltering here on the banks of the Boy Man. I'm in my tighty whities and white socks, and that's it. A pint of Newcastle Brun.
It's not too, but 100 yards from my front door, we had like a music festival thing last night on a big public park. It was excellent. So I was over there with the kids all day yesterday, and then we ended up walking around the road to about 11 o'clock at night, and it was lovely weather here. But
what do you mean? Are you enjoying the Chris? Are you enjoying the baseball?
I turned it off. I'm just keep checking. I keep checking for an update in hours, but it's still showing rain delay. Nightmare.
All I know is when you broadcast this podcast, just make sure you say, the boys get together and Harper and his tidy whities discuss the Mets possibly going forward.
Listen, there'll be loads of complaints about me taking my jeans off, the noise in my belt, the can opening, the pouring, the crisps, the chocolate.
You've got thick skin, mate. You've got thick skin. That's how you roll.
That thick heat.
See the... On you go, Nicky.
No, I was going to say, to get to a point, though, about the Mets is... I don't think, to go to Frankie's, like, if they spend money, I don't think they're spending much money this year. Maybe there was some rumor. I mean, Adam Rubin has this report. I just don't know how much you could trust Adam Rubin. But, you know, maybe I could see them adding a couple of million. There's a lot of players coming off the payroll. Like, Kelfrey could be one of them. Torres is eligible. He could be another one. Haston's off. Ramirez is off. That's $2-3 million. Bardak is off. So they're losing, I think overall, if all those guys disappear, they're freeing up $17 million in payroll. However, with all the raises to some of these players, Wright gets a raise, Dickey gets a raise, I forget who, a couple of the players get raises, it all down, and Johan, I think, gets a large chunk of his contract last year. I think it was a backloaded contract. So it almost takes back to the almost even keel. So I really think, to go to Harper's original point, is that I think they're going to build off the nucleus they have now. And they're not going to add payroll. They're going to go for similar to what we saw last season. If they can find a free agent out there that could add value to the team for $1 to $2 million, they'll make a play. And I think that's unfortunately what we're going to have to deal with going for the 2013 season. But there's one option that comes into play that might make us players for a free agent this year. The Mets, after 2013, in 2014, right now, have nobody on contract, I think, outside of John Neese. All their contracts come to an end this year or next year, for most of the players. So what the Mets could do if they wanted to get creative, and this has been hinted around, I'm not sure if the, you know, ownership is comfortable with it, is saying, especially with David Wright's negotiations, David Wright might command, say, $16, $17 million a year, They could turn and say, how about for year one, we give you 15, and for year two, three, four, five, we'll give you 17, you know, 16, 17 million dollars. They could backload some contracts if the free agent is willing and really wants to come to New York, because they have nothing on the payroll for 2014. And that's why the Mets right now, their stance is, we're going to do what we got to do to get through this year. They showed that in the offseason. And they're doing the same thing this year. I don't expect a huge payroll jump. They're playing for 2014. You'll have the two kids ready in the rotation, maybe the three. You'll have a lot of payroll to work with. So, yeah, they're not spending a lot this year, but the Mets are going to keep the nucleus they have now. And I really think their play is not 2013. It's for 2014.
Do you not think the All-Star game comes into the equation?
No.
About how we want to improve this team, and because all eyes are on the Mets. And
the All-Star game is going to make you money regardless. Season ticket packages, maybe not full season, but season ticket packages are going to increase next year no matter who they put on the field, because people want to experience an All-Star game.
Mm-hmm.
I've already renewed my season tickets, and I'm sure every season ticket holder now is going to say, I'm just going to do it next year just because I'll get All-Star game tickets. And then these people are going to go out and buy a 15-game plan because it'll guarantee them an All-Star package.
But so is there something though, Nicky, about the club where we want to improve the ball club because the All-Star game, because all eyes are on the Mets, or is that just completely off the mark?
No, because when it comes down to the All-Star game, like, where was it this year? Kansas City?
Mm-hmm.
I didn't give a shit what the Royals did, you know? Like, no other fan will really say, oh, what are the Royals doing this year because they're hosting the All-Star game? All they care about is that stadium is in pristine condition for 3 days in July.
Yeah, the only thing is, who's going to buy tickets besides season ticket holders next year? They're not going to get, like, the people that bought tickets this year. They're really not.
What do you mean?
I mean, just the crowds of 30-something thousand. They're not going to have that next year.
Well, yeah.
And they're not. They're not. They're not going to have the Met fan that goes to five games a year. He's going to go to less and less games. And you're basically telling the New York fans, hey, because you know the Yankees are going to go out and make another big splash, because they're the Yankees. They're going to go out, they're going to buy somebody else, and then we're going to sit there and go get, you know, some schmuck who makes $2 million a year. I still think that the Mets will pick up like a $10 million kind of bat. I do.
I'd love it. No, I hope you're right.
I do.
But in warm-up, guy, our game's about to start. Happy days.
Oh, okay.
It's warm. Sorry, carry on. Sorry for butting in.
Oh, no. It's just I really do. I think we're going to go out and get a guy that makes $10 million a year, has a right-handed bat, and hits, you know, 28 to 33 home runs a year. I do.
I hope you're right, because we need it. Even if it's the only move they make, we need a power bat. But right-handed power bat. I just really do think that they're not looking to make a splash, and I think they're going to ride the All-Star game next year. People will buy packages for them, and that's really what they care about. Yeah, they want walk-ups, and you want to average. I think they're up to 29,000 per game this year, which is going to decrease from here on out because they have a lot more home games, and let's face it, the team's out of it, so people aren't going to go.
Yeah.
But I really think they're going to push the future is now Harvey Wheeler type of thing and try to get people excited for the future of the team.
You know, they still want to make money.
Oh, of course.
And you can't make money in the New York market without spending money. You just can't do it.
See, when you're talking about fans there, Nicky, Frankie, right, this is always something I've always thought about, right? Because it's New York, and I know it's not going to be a big thing, but what kind of percentage of the crowd do you think is tourists? You're just there on a weekend, like on holiday in New York, because obviously New York's it's a massive place for visitors for the UK and Ireland, all over the world, basically. How many people do you think just turn up because they're there for a one-off game as tourists and that? Yankees as well, obviously.
I would say at a Yankee or Met game, I would say on any given day, I'd say maybe 5% of the crowd.
I mean, that's quite big, like, because Jason, if you think that would never come into play for, like, the Celtic, like, that kind of number. Tourists, like.
No, but I mean, obviously Glasgow's got far less tourists than New York. Yeah, I mean, New York's one of the biggest tourist destinations in the world.
That's what I mean. New York must really, places like New York and LA and Boston, I suppose, must really kind of benefit for that sort of thing.
Oh, you know, and the thing is when you ever, whenever you see the European tourists here at a game, they always have a couple of bags from the team store. Always. So it's like they're going in the team store dropping, you know, $100 at least, you know, in money on merchandise, which, you know, most Met fans aren't going into to the clubhouse stores and buying merchandise there. We go to Modell's and buy our stuff, you know.
Yeah, no, and for instance, this upcoming Friday, you've got one of my friends, and I think is there four or five of them that are coming in.
Jason, you should be on commission.
It's Sunday,
Big Baz and
Jason, you should be on commission. Frankie, you should be charging for tours.
I know, the big man does me proud. And Donovan's, I hope they give Frankie plenty of drinks on the tap.
I hope so.
Yeah, because the business that you take into that pub, mate, for the steak pie and the bunkers.
Definitely.
It's absolutely. Sorry, where was I going there? I think visitors for the UK especially, if you're sports orientated and you're taking a trip to New York, you're going on to Ticketmaster and you're going looking at what sporting events are coming up. Because obviously, if people aren't familiar with American sports, they maybe wouldn't know baseball's a summer game, then basketball runs maybe, sort of covers part of the baseball season, and then your American football's your winter game. So, essentially, they maybe wouldn't know that, but they would Google up, find out if the sporting events are on, and they would either go to the Garden to see the Knicks, and or it's Yankee Stadium, Shea Stadium, or it's going out to, well, the one that they probably wouldn't attend would be the Giants or Jets because of the price of the tickets. You know, that would be.
You just don't, and those tickets are they're harder to come by, and it's out in New Jersey. It's a little different. The tourists usually go to either the hockey at the Garden or the Knicks at the Garden or the Mets or the Yankees in the summertime. That's where you'll see the tourists at.
Yep. And I don't think the Yankees would get more than the Mets because I think it's just whoever anybody's whatever
home,
time
eh?
You're in the city, whoever's at home, they would just go because they just want to take in a sports game. Because when I was in LA, we went and seen the Angels, and it was a bit further out, but rather than the Dodgers because they were at home, you know, and it was just whoever I picked. But I just noticed Kansas City away to the White Sox. Kansas were on a no-hitter there, but the White Sox have just got hit in the seventh inning.
Jason, I have to say, like, when I was on my honeymoon in New York, I was still a kind of fledgling Mets fan. Do you know that way where I was just like, I was watching them on the television a wee bit. But if at that time I was on my honeymoon, if the Mets had been on the road, and God, man, please God, thank God that never happened, but if the Yankees had been at home, I would have went and seen the Yankees then. And there's every chance I'd have been sitting here than now, a scumbag.
That's fate, mate. That's fate.
Aye.
You know, that's the righteous things happen to the righteous people.
That's right.
But I don't know how you guys. Here's a question, right? See, when you're in New York, like, if I'm in New York, I'll just wear a Mets hat constantly, right? So, see, when you get into sports stores, obviously, if you're on holiday, so you're getting into sports stores, you're buying some presents for coming home and stuff like that. But it's unbelievable how many Yankees hats they sell compared to Mets hats. You get into some sports stores and they've only got a small, and okay, in relative terms they sell loads of Mets gear as well, but the Yankees marketing department must be unbelievable compared to the Mets, you know, because how many Mets stores is there in New York City? Is there only two? There's one at Bryant Park. Is there any other ones?
Jason, just before the boys answer that, the thing the Yankees have done, right, which has been a stroke of genius, that NY badge has become more a symbol in New York than it has of the Yankees outside of New York, if you know what I mean. Like tourists, like, oh, Jason, you know yourself.
Shots here. One of the most commonly worn hats. I bet you it's the most popular hat anywhere. I'm one at Glasgow City Centre. I'll pass like three, four people wearing Yankees. That's on every day.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, you watch like an English Premier League game. You only see Yankee hats. I actually did see a Met hat at the City game this morning. But the thing about the Yankees is that, like to hit what Hoppe said, they're a global brand. They're historic. They've been around longer. They've been successful. They've been, you know, so their brand in the country alone, the Yankees were always the hated team and the most popular team throughout the history of baseball. And then they started attracting the overseas interest, you know. I mean,
but Nicky, wait a minute, Nicky. See how you're saying they're a global brand, right? They've been so clever about it, though, because they're a global brand in the UK without actually being the Yankees brand. The Yankees brand have actually became the New York brand, and it's so cool to have a New York hat. I'm telling you right now, I would gamble at least 75%. Yeah, the young people, the 25 and under, who are walking about with these NY caps on, don't even know they're anything to do with the Yankees. That's such a clever, genius move as marketing. It's unbelievable, like.
Jay-Z.
Yeah.
Jay-Z wears a Yankee cap all the time. That's why half of these kids wear Yankee caps.
Yeah, that stuff like that. No, you're absolutely right. So the Mets should just get some famous New Yorker or whatever, pay him money to wear a Mets hat, how it starts.
Or get a tie-in with Celtic.
Nah, it's just like the only guy that wears a Mets cap.
you've got me as well.
All we need is Neil Lennon to wear a Mets hat a couple of times and we're in. We're golden.
I just got a text from a mate in Liverpool there, getting away for the baseball. It says Michael Owen has just signed a one-year deal with Everton, pay as you play.
Whoa.
So not a bad deal for Everton.
I'd say so.
It's as pay as you play.
I'd have took him at Celtic.
I've been far too much money for
that. I'd have took him as a. If he'd, I know it would have, but if it'd been an agreeable thing with him and that, I would have definitely had him in a jersey.
Aye, pay as you play.
Aye.
Yep. But here's hoping it works out. But and Sal send the copy. He's absolutely reeling because he was a hero of theirs. He's went to Man United. Now he's gone to Everton.
Yeah,
and he was a boyhood Everton fan. I think his father played with Everton, so there you go.
Yeah.
So what we're looking for this week, we're looking for Harper says he's looking for 5 out of 7. I would say no nods will probably get swept one of the series.
Jason, that's the thing, eh? That's the thing. See, whenever we think we're on a good thing, that's when it all goes tits up.
I think the pressure playing at New York as well doesn't seem to sit well with some of these guys in the team, but I'm going to be positive and I'm going to say we're going to get 5 out of 7 as well. What about Nicky and Frankie?
4-3.
4-3.
What games are we talking about?
Four to the Rockies, 3 to the Astros.
I think we can win 5 of those games.
3 against the Rockies and 2 against the Astros. That's what I'm looking for.
See if we were still competing just now. Because see, on paper it wouldn't have been. But after this, we've got a road trip. We're away to Philadelphia and Miami. I mean, these two teams are absolutely guff. They're worse than us. You know, and if we were up there competing, this would be a perfect time just to cement our place. But it's a gutter.
Jason, you're tempting fate with that comment, mate. I know.
I mean, that's the thing. They're absolutely. They, two of them are brutal, and they're like 2 and 2.5 games behind us. So, if they were a type of streak together, I can't see them doing it, to be honest with you. But what do you expect from next season for Miami? I know they spent a lot of money this season, and then they've traded a load of their guys away. But do you think they'll make a push and spend big money again next year, or is that they've had their shot at it and that's it?
That's it. They saw it. People still aren't coming out to the park.
Yep.
Even with the downtown location, people still aren't. Miami is a rough sports town. It really is. I mean, it's a college state. They love their college football, and so it's a rough sports town. So it's they just I don't think they'll spend money. I think they're going to try to win World Series like they always have, you know, with young players and hope to get lucky one year.
Jason, just we've got a caller. I don't know if it's popped up on the screen. Has it?
Yeah.
We've got Gary McGeady calling us, not from his usual haunt up in the north.
He's calling us from Florida.
He's calling all the way from Orlando.
Oh.
Gary, take it away, man.
Can you hear me, yeah?
Loud and clear.
Yeah,
Perfect, mate. How you doing?
I'm dead on. I've got better Skype reception here than I have at home.
I was just going to say that.
That's right.
Everything's better in America, isn't it?
Just Gary, you'd be as well just staying there.
So, you were going to Tropicana Field, mate. Have you been yet, or have you still to go?
I think I'll go on Wednesday. There's a day game on Wednesday and there's a day game next Sunday.
Okay.
I think I'll do both of them because the night games means I have to steal the car and leave the wife and kids with nothing to do. So Wednesday and Saturday, I seen there they have the Patriots are playing on Saturday night in Tampa and they must have some sort of pre-season friendlies.
That's right.
Yeah. I'm not really in the NFL, but I might go down Saturday night and take that in, and then there's a day game on the Sunday at the Trop.
Very good. That's excellent. I remember going to that Ferg's Bar. It's just round the. It's like 2 minutes from the stadium. Cracking big sports bar. Do some great barbecue food and stuff like that. And it's got a big outdoor area. And as Frankie and Nicky said, they're absolutely nuts in their college football there. So there's. I don't know if the college football season is that on just now, or has it not started yet?
Still a couple of weeks left. Yeah.
So there'll be none on then. But when we were there. Is it South Florida University?
Yeah, the Bulls. Yeah, they're actually that they just new up and coming. The three big ones are one's in Miami, one's in Tallahassee. No, one's in Miami.
Tallahassee
is Florida State, and Gainesville is University of Florida.
But South Florida's and Tampa's getting pretty big now.
Yeah, Tampa's getting pretty big. The Bulls.
Gary's never been to the bar you're talking about, Jason, because he goes there just about every year.
Have you been to the bar, Gary?
Sorry, what did you say?
Have you been into Ferg's Bar before?
No, I don't really go to bars.
Nah.
I'll be driving, you see. I'll be driving straight up and down because I'm staying in Orlando. So
right.
No, I've been to the Trop before, but I've never been to the bar.
What did you think of the stadium? I thought it was okay.
I thought it was great. I see, a lot of people, anyone that you were listening to that's American and frequents a lot of ballparks slate it and say it's garbage, but I thought it was dead on.
Yeah, I think, Frankie, see, for us, it's just getting to see some Major League Baseball.
That's so exactly it. It's just a chance to see a real, proper, meaningful match, you know?
Yeah. And with the Glasgow School of Jibbing, myself and Linda, we got the cheapest tickets and then just black right down behind home plate. Obviously.
The same idea myself, because you can pick up tickets for like $3 and stuff.
Yeah.
And then, you know, when you go to Trop, it's going to be empty anyway, so you can just dander down.
Well, we actually, the game we went to was the Yankees, and it was unbelievable. There was more Yankee fans in it than there was Tampa fans, and that was great. The Rays won, and we were going berserk, and these Yankee fans next to us hated me.
I think it's Kansas City is the match on Wednesday, and then the Mariners on next Sunday, so I don't imagine there'll be a huge crowd.
I'll be absolutely dead. Yeah. I seen Seattle play the LA Angels, and it's the same side as it. Oh, it's a bit of a drive, but there was absolutely no Mariners fans in the stadium. You know, there was a couple, but very, very few. And obviously in Florida, you'll always get people on vacation and stuff like that. So you'll always get some fans, and you got a load of. Obviously, there'll be a pile of people from Seattle living the Florida sort of region because of obviously its location, it's warm and stuff like that. So you could have quite a few fans there. But here's hoping you see some good ball action. So what was you specifically call up to? Just call up for a general chit chat, or did you have any points?
Well, it's weird because now that I'm in American time zone, I can't follow baseball. you know, I work permanent nights.
Yeah,
so it's ideal for me, but I'm sitting here now. Yesterday, I didn't even know that the Red Sox match was on. It was an afternoon game. It must have been at Yankee Stadium. And I go home last night, put on that bat and says, well, I'll watch this Red Sox game, but they'd already won 4-1.
Yes!
All the shite that I've sat and watched this season when they lose.
I know.
And they win at Yankee Stadium, and I didn't even know it was on.
I actually sympathise with you there because when I was in Florida a couple of years ago, it was the same. You tune in because baseball to us is a total nighthawk game. Mm-hmm.
That's a night game, eh?
Yeah.
Jason, it was the same when I was in Las Vegas last year. The games were in the afternoon, but the chances of me getting Vicky to sit in a casino to watch the Mets for 3 hours in the afternoon in Las Vegas was no chance.
I can't even set my fantasy team. You keep forgetting. You say, I'll do it later tonight, then you realise, tune in, and you've missed half the games.
It's not affecting you too much. You're romping that league, mate.
I checked it there now. T, you're getting beat after. Oh dear, I thought, oh my god, that guy's bragging all week.
I know. But the Mets game. Aye, the Mets game just started, so I've got three players sort of in. So here's four.
Three Mets players.
Aye, I've got
are
three Mets players in my lineup. Aye, I've got three in my lineup. So.
Gary, see, as commissioner, can you clear someone up? Jason was asking me this morning, I can't remember, right? So your fantasy league, how many teams make the playoffs?
Six, I think.
I think
if you lose today, you're out of it.
Oh, me, I'm finishing bottom of the league, don't worry about that.
No, I think...
Even with David Wright, my team.
That was a nice trade, that.
I tell you, he's been hopeless. David Wright, he's just put one up there, and he just get caught. So we get two outs, turn on first base. So what do you think about the Red Sox, mate?
I know you're saying he's been hopeless, but I keep watching that the WAR figure.
Yeah, I think obviously the standard he's set, we're maybe expecting too much, but no, he's been average, which is probably not the David Wright we've been used to, because he's normally excelling. But since the All-Star break, he's been no better than average. I think he's maybe needing a rest.
We've lost Gary.
Have we lost Gary?
Aye.
Hello.
He's back. He's back.
You there?
He's back.
Yeah. Gary, you're back. Jason was asking just before you cut off, what do you think about the Red Sox this year and that? And maybe Bobby, a wee bit of comments on Bobby V. Oh, he's away again. He's away again. Aye.
What do you guys, Nicky and Frankie, what do you think of the Red Sox?
Hello?
Oh, he's back again. Gary, you there?
Getting
it. Gary. He's definitely there, he's on.
Can you hear us, Gary?
He's cut off again, he's obviously having problems there.
So if he's listening to the podcast, what do you, Frankie and Nicky, what do you think of the Red Sox at present?
I think they still have a chance to make the wild card, but... Bobby Valentine, they got a lot of egos on their team, and Bobby Valentine just couldn't get a handle on it. We love Bobby Valentine, but you know, the Red Sox problems, I think it goes beyond, yeah, Bobby Valentine isn't helping, obviously, but it goes beyond Bobby Valentine. They got a lot of whiny players on their team, and their pitching staff just wasn't that good, and it's showing now, and they got time to blow the team up and start over if I'm the Red Sox. And they could fire Bobby Valentine. I can understand they don't want to do that. But I think the problems are, yes, Bobby Valentine has been great. He's obviously maybe lost his touch or something. I don't know. But the problems are beyond Bobby Valentine with the Red Sox. It's time to start over.
Frankie, I was a wee bit disappointed in you this week, man.
Why?
Because they were all having a pop at Bobby V. On the rounders thread, and I thought you would have been in there and had his back. I even changed my avatar to the fake nose and glasses and all that, moustache, that Jason had to explain to them because nobody got it.
it's beyond Bobby V, and it's that team is, they're all prima donnas. No matter who was coaching those guys, it could have been Miller Huggins or, you know, the greatest coaches of all time. Case Stengel, they're going to have the problems that they have. They just have to blow that team up and go from start from scratch. They got some good young players. They got to get their act together. Pedroia and the outfielder's name, Jesus Christ, Ellsberg. But the pitching staff is a joke, and it all started with that. Crawford deal,
yep.
Giving him that kind of money.
Now he's asking for Tommy John surgery.
Yeah, I mean, come on, the guy's done. We think we got it bad with David Bay. I think they got it worse. But it's not Bobby V, and it goes back to Theo Epstein and John Henry, the owner. They're the ones who created this mess, and they're the ones that should help. Well, Theo's gone, but Henry's got to clean this mess up, and I think they will get rid of Bobby V eventually. It's not even his fault.
Hey, I just want one thing. I just got to say, in like 10, 15 minutes, we got to wrap it up in New York.
Yeah. No worries, mate. The thing with Bobby V for me is, do you think he actually regrets going there? Because he had a right cushy number with ESPN. And, you know, sitting in his studio talking about baseball. And but I suppose the lure of a big team, it's always going to maybe prove too great, and you have to maybe take that punt at him. I'm sure at times he says, I wish I was back sitting in that studio now.
Well, do you get Gary? Do you want to answer that? We've got Gary back.
I was just going to ask the boys what they thought with a Bobby V carry on. I mean, I think his days are numbered at Boston for sure. And I think from both points of view, his and the support anyway, they seem to have turned against him. But
Gary, do you think that's a wee bit unfair? Considering how the players have been performing, I think it's deserved.
The players are definitely. I don't think there's one reason to blame for the way the Red Sox have gone.
Exactly. That's,
The players are certainly to blame. Like, I thought they get rid of Nicklaus and they thought he was reputed to be in a cancer in the dressing room, as they called it. But it still continued. And definitely Bobby V. The stories last week of 17 players approaching the owners. Expressing their displeasure with the manager, there has to be something in that too. But ultimately, as the boys were saying, it's pitching staff more than anything have sold them down the river, and particularly the likes of Beckett this year. It's been scandalous. The guys get earning huge money, and he just seems to have an arrogant reputation where I'll go out and do it, and if I don't do it, it sucks too bad, you know. But yeah. I don't know. I agree. It's time to rip it up. There's a few. There's more talent than the position, Brent, you know. And I'd be hopeful for next year, but it really is time to go back to the drawing board because there's too many guys in big money not performing. And I don't think Bobby V's... I think he's to blame as well. He's definitely played his part in it. It's just an absolute shitball, and it really needs, from top to bottom, rebuilt.
Yeah.
But similar
here's the thing. You're 6.5 games out of the wild card race. Say he gets into the wild card and he wins the World Series, you know. We've got to the start of October, so you've got a third of August left, and then
still going on, eh?
So there's still the best part of 40 games to play.
And say I watch them most nights, and to be honest, they're just not good enough. There's no way. When you see guys going out to pitch and they're giving up 5 and 6 runs in the first or second innings, and these are they're supposedly starters now. I've always thought John Lester would put it right, which he did. He won last night, but Lester, I think his last 4 starts now, they've all been quality starts. So I'm hopeful there. The bullpen's been fine, but it's just you just watch the team and you just think there's just something missing. It's as if they're not a team at all. They're just individuals, weagles, you know.
I mean, well, Gary, you watch them every night, like, so that's, you would know, it's fair enough, like.
I mean, I can't understand, I don't know how important the manager is, because once the team's out there, they're out there. You know, and if you've guys making stupid errors, throwing errors, guys that are just pitching, leaving stupid balls up that are getting hammered, I don't know what you can do, you know.
But the thing is, if you're saying, like, if there's 17 players approaching front office saying they're not happy with the manager, then that's in their heads as well. Like it's not. It doesn't make for a psychological sort of happiness, or I don't know. I can't even find the proper words, but you know what I mean. It doesn't make for a kind of. It's not very harmonious. Like,
come the end of August last year, we were the best team in baseball without a doubt, and the same bunch of players blew it up in September. Couldn't win a fucking game, and it was shocking. So. A lot of it has to be down to the players. It really does. Mm-hmm. It's weird when you watch them every night. You know, I haven't lost interest, but now you just shrug your shoulders when they get beat. It's just like, nah, there's another one, you know, and all their stupid. Whereas earlier in the season, there's still hope. You think it's going to turn around. It's going to turn around. There's too much quality in the team, but it ain't turning around, you know. Mm-hmm. As they make the playoffs, it would be an injustice against, because a lot of teams have played are just better teams. They're better ball clubs, better players.
I wish we were 6.5 games off the wild card. There you go, mate.
Well, what are you saying? I know you're pretty poor at the moment.
I'm only 9.
Only?
Nah, it's only three and more than 6.
It's funny. I know we keep staying about it, but every time, we've only played at Yankee Stadium twice this year. I've seen the Friday night game. See that? Every single ball just goes for a home run. It is unreal. I think there was 5 home runs on Friday night, all of them were solo homers. It was incredible. Any ball at all, just bang. It's out, it's over the park. And you're thinking, Jesus Christ.
Don't get Nicky and Frankie started.
See, listen, see the thing about saying you're only six and a half games at, because I'm just looking, right, there's six and a half games at the wild card. The Mets are nine games at the wild card, right? We're actually, we're the same amount of teams behind, if you like, right?
Five.
In either division, right? And it's all right saying you're so many games behind, but it's the teams that are in front of you that you need to lose, and you just look at those teams and you think it's all right for us to go on a run, but it's them to go on a losing run as well, which is a double-edged sword.
You need 4 out of 5 to blow up.
Aye, and the teams that are in front of you, they're pretty good teams. Like,
who's in the National League? Who's in front of us? I know the Angels are one.
The Angels, the Tigers,
Tampa Bay, Baltimore. So two in your own division.
Tampa Bay, Baltimore, Oakland, Detroit, and the Angels.
I don't think
it's going to happen to them either.
No, I resigned it a long time ago.
And yeah. we've got the Diamondbacks, Cardinals, Dodgers, Pittsburgh, and Atlanta in front of us. Not going to happen either.
We can forget it. We can absolutely forget it.
I'm just wanting to finish in front of Philadelphia, to be honest with you.
Tell you what, I was at Universal Studios yesterday. Jeez, there's some amount of Phillies fans about.
Really, eh?
Them and Yankees. Yous would love it. They'd be heaven for yous. Everybody was either a Yankee or a Phillies fan.
Me and Jason would be fighting all night.
We're all big fat fuckers too.
Yeah, there you go. A bit of stereotypical there.
That was horrible.
You enjoyed
it? Anyway, guys, I was just calling in to say hello, and I actually wanted to hear what the guys in New York thought about Bobby V thing, because it has gone completely pear shaped, but I caught up while I was offline, and there's not much you can disagree with, to be honest, what they were saying.
It's time to get rid of everybody there. Start anew. Yeah.
One last thing before I go. I bought a New York newspaper this morning. I could not believe the amount of Yankee coverage in it. Unbelievable. I think it was about 12 pages just of Yankee coverage.
What's that, the Daily News?
Had a ton. If you're in Orlando, you want to get it's a Post. Oh wow. That's we're used to that. I mean, they dominate the headlines just the way it is. You know, yeah, it's a Yankee town.
I have to get to the 7th or 8th back page before I've seen one page in the Mets.
Well, Gary, I'm going to tell you that'll all be over once the Cosmos come back.
Yeah.
Anyway, I've
got
to go on here because I have to go out.
Right, Gary. Take care,
Gary. Gary, thanks for calling, man. Listen, enjoy the rest of the holiday and mind turn up for the flight on the right day.
Yeah, Jesus. There's no chance of me not doing that or I'm for divorce.
Right, man. Cheers, bro.
Okay, lads, cheers.
All the best, man. See you.
By the way, Hoppe, we might have to do a follow-up podcast soon, too, on that stuff.
The Cosmos.
A lot of info coming out.
Well, listen, Nicky, any time you want, man, because it was one of the most pop numbers wise, it was very, very popular, and the feedback shows there is a big interest in the New York Cosmos for the Celtic community. So anytime you want to do that, man, definitely 100%.
I enjoyed it as well. So have we got anything to add, guys, because we could just wrap this up. I think we've covered most things. And so next week you won't be available, Frankie, because you're going to the game next Sunday.
Frankie just went to the loo. Yeah, no, I think he's going to the game Sunday. I have a wedding Saturday, so I don't know. I mean, I could try to be available for Sunday, but I don't know. I was thinking of heading to the game myself.
All right, no, go for it, but we can talk on Twitter, Facebook, stuff like that. We can arrange it for someday next week or whatever, or we can give it a rest and wait till the following week.
Would you be interested in doing a podcast before the game, like in the morning? Is that any good to you? Like, say, 11 a.m.?
I mean, that works for me. I mean, that Sunday morning, I'm available pretty early.
Because it's a 6 o'clock for us, Jason, so 11 a.m. for them is like 11... 12, 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 o'clock, I mean, that works for me. Like, I don't know, what's Celtics?
The thing is, at 11 a.m., I mean, we would only be able to stay on for an hour tops. We'd have to shoot over to the stadium then.
Nah, it'd still be something, though.
Yeah, we could do something like that. We build up to the game.
It's better than nothing.
We'll
get something organised, right? So, Barry, Frankie, you take good care of Big Baz and the boys next Sunday. Show them the finer points of Queens, and the big man, he's really looking forward to it.
Yeah.
So,
and Frankie, you didn't be sleeping in or taking too much sleep or anything, man, because he's got...
I know, rip Van Fraser there. Did you get enough sleep last night, big man?
not really. I'm still pretty tired, man.
By the way, I seen a couple of videos of both of you guys in it. Frankie was showing me some of the videos he shot outside the stadium in Philadelphia. both of you are in it. It looked amazing. It looked someday. But they were filming in the stadium. The heat must have been terrible.
Oh, it was awful. Awful. They ran out of
that game. Bloody hell.
Yeah.
They ran out of water.
Yeah. The stadium was a quarter filled and they ran out of water.
Yeah.
Because when it was flashing around about the crowd, and see the Celtic support there. Bloody hell, it was massive.
Yeah.
See when he was running his camera around the ground, it got to like Windsor and Jerry and stuff like that. They all had like t-shirts over their heads and everything because it just looked as if you were baking.
Yeah, it was hot.
What, 95? Something like that.
Yeah, I don't know. It kind of ruined the day a little bit because like when you get back to the bus, you didn't really want to drink beer because it was so. Me personally, I just wanted to stay hydrated. I was miserably hot, but whatever. It was still a good day. It's very rare. You get to see Celtics, so
yeah.
I know, excellent guys. So I'll be there next year. If we get a game, and I'll make sure the Mets have got a homestead. It would be a terrible dilemma for me if Celtic were playing there and the Mets were on the road. You know, I'd be like, oh man, they're coming because I'd always want to see two games anyway.
You know what? You get to see Celtic every weekend. Real deal.
I would take them to Brooklyn and go to.
No, I would need to make sure the Mets are at home. I would never book a holiday there. I don't think I would come to America again rather than the summer and just to see the Mets. I mean even next year I would consider when we're doing a road trip to Chicago, I would love to go to Chicago.
I would
love to do it when even a few guys would be up for it or something like that, going for a couple of days to Chicago. I'd love to do it. See if you're in New York, see a return flight to Chicago from LaGuardia or wherever. How much are you talking? Money, much dollars.
Flight, it's expensive now. It's going to be $200-$300 round trip.
Yeah, is that right?
Well, if you come and you want to go to Chicago, I'll just book one of my nifty little business trips around it, and we'll go hit some baseball games at night. Yeah.
How far is? I get disproportionate to the size of America. How far is it to go to Chicago on the train? You're probably talking about 12 hours, isn't it?
The train's going to be longer than 12 hours. Yeah, it's going to be 18 hours
that's
probably.
That's mad, like,
Yeah, no, you're better off just flying, you know.
2 hours.
It's under 2 hours, so absolutely get on a plane.
Gate to gate, 2 hours.
Yeah.
Nicky, Frankie, I just want you to say as well, loads of comments on the Homeboys the day after the Homeboys show last Monday night. Everybody loved your... The wee bit we played, obviously we spoke about it with MetsBhoys and we played the recording the Homeboys when you were talking about being in Philly and that. Everybody loved the crack. So, listen, man, I'm desperate to get you on the Homeboys 1 week.
Yeah, we got to get on.
I'll get on there. You know what? Actually, in 2 weeks is Labor Day.
It's on a Monday.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think I have a barbecue, but I could try to sneak out somewhere and call up for a little bit. Yeah, it's a wear off. So I'd love to get on. I mean, I'd love to get on tomorrow to talk about match yesterday.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
I'll be honest, his comments, his post-game comments surprised me. He was pretty delighted. And we were thinking, like, we were all angry that we were so happy just to get a point.
Mm-hmm.
I know. And it's a lot of them looked as if they were just going through the motions. But then when the last 10 minutes, the urgency we showed was excellent. You know, and you say to yourself, why can't we do that at the start?
That's what we were saying.
They had three or four great chances before they actually scored. I mean,
Commons was a man of the match for Celtic.
Yeah, Commons had a he earlier on he had a chance that he buried right into the keeper's chest, you know. But what I was saying to Frankie is his service on the corner kicks is very good.
There's just nobody there.
There's nobody there to put a head to it though. Sometimes it's frustrating.
There isn't. There's never anybody there to put a head in the ball. Samaras is no bad in the air as a guy who can flick the ball on, but as an attacking threat in the air, he's not up to much. Like I was very the biggest thing I took for the game was Tony Watt. I thought Tony Watt was very positive when he came on. He doesn't look out of place, and he looks like a young Superman, which is always a bonus.
Yeah. And he had a chance later on, didn't he?
Yeah, he had a chance.
Well, the goal came off him. A young guy, he still had to put that shot on target, make the keeper make a save, and we got the goal at it. So, no, I was very impressed with Tony Watt. I was disappointed he didn't start the game, to be honest.
Yeah. And you play Samaras up front, you can just forget it.
Aye. So, 2 weeks is Labour Day.
Yep.
Now, that's something to look forward to, because I'm desperate to get you guys on. And I know for a fact that people will lap up hearing different voices, for us fools anyway, for a start, and just get that New York perspective and all that kind of stuff. No, man, desperate to get you on. That'd be good crack.
And we can cover a bit of the cosmos as well while you're on.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. And listen, just to anybody that's listening, for you guys as well, Jason's privy to this, but keep an eye on hailhailmedia.com next weekend, and there's going to be some exciting developments. That's all I can say for the minute.
Alright. Okay, guys. All so, right. Been a pleasure talking to you again. Well, I'll need to get into the habit at the start of the show.
Oh, shit, Jason, sorry. Just before you go, quick, can I ask you a question? I got a question sent to us for the parrot. And the parrot wanted to know, they didn't know to find it. Oh, shit. His question was, he wanted to ask Frankie and Nicky, do the Mets have any food beverage unique to the stadium? Beer type of hot dog that's unique to the Mets? That was his question.
You got it in New York, sorry.
There's the Shake Shack, there's Blue Smoke. I gotta be honest, if you're in New York City and the tourist, what you want is those sausage and pepper sandwiches.
Or Mama's.
Or Mama's or Corona's down right field, but because that's a local, good local sandwich shop. But I would say the sausage and peppers. I mean, I'm sure you get it in a lot of stadiums, but it's New York. It's pretty good stuff. We enjoy the sausage and peppers.
I mean, that new place, the Gyro Place?
Yeah, there's a Gyro Place down right field.
Greek place, you know?
If you go down the right field line in the corner, if you're walking the concourse.
Over the bridge? Shea Bridge?
No, but, go to the corner of right field, like kind of like you'll be like almost standing underneath the Pepsi porch. There's an area called like the World's Fair, and back there is a gyro shop, Mama's a Corona, and stuff like that. And then there's a seafood type of joint underneath there too. So just go back there, you'll definitely find some unique food.
You're definitely not going to go hungry. The only thing is the line for that Shake Shack, bloody hell, there was no way I was waiting on that. No chance, but you'd have been waiting there for about half an hour. They missed half the bloody game. But so it's been a pleasure talking to you guys again. We're currently 0-0 in the middle of the second inning. They're just going up to bat, and we've had three hits and no runs so far. So here's hoping we can win the rubber game here.
I'm going back to the pub.
Right, guys, are you?
She came in, after we just started that, and she's writing. I'm like, what you want? No, it's all sign language. Okay, they're sign language. And she's writing notes. I'm going back out. Give me money out of your pocket. So she's away at the pub next door where, I don't know, some of her pals are. That's exactly where I'm going. I put the jeans back on, the trainers are back on, and I'm out the door.
Happy days. Enjoy your pint, mate.
Yeah, believe it.
Nicky and Frankie, we'll speak to you during the week, guys. And let's go, Mets.
Let's go, Mets.
Are they away?
No, they're still on. Just no talking.
Maybe they've come off or something.
Right, I'll leave them on anyway while we play it, right?
No worries. Right. Cheers later, guys.
Cheers.
Let's go, Matt. Bye.
From Highline Field in St. Petersburg, Florida, on a warm, sunny Saturday afternoon, it's a day for baseball history. The first appearance in competition of New York City National League baseball team, the New York Mets.
Line into left field, base hit for Carter, and the Mets are still alive.
Just a small town girl, living in a lonely world. He took the midnight train going anywhere. Just a city boy.
Little roller up along first, behind the bag.
Thank you. A singer in a smoky room, a smell of wine and cheap perfume. For a smile they can share the night. It goes on and on.
Lopez wants it away.
And it's hit deep to left center. Andrew Jones on the run. This one has a chance. Home run! Mike Piazza and the Mets lead 3-2.
To the right, into the air to center field. Damon going back to the warning track. It's over his head, and the Mets win it. David Wright with a walk-off hit in the bottom of the ninth off Mariano Rivera, and the Mets have taken game one from the Yankees, 7-6.